All right. We are the Lord's people in the Lord's house on the Lord's day. We do it every weekend. Amen? Amen. I don't know about you guys. I saw most of you raise your hand. It's been a long time since I've sang a whole worship set of hymnals. I think the last time I sang it, I was much shorter. And we had someone either telling us to turn to the hymnal page or someone was putting the transparency on the projector. Anybody relate to that? Anybody grow up in that? And then in the South, we'd go to the fellowship hall, we'd eat some fried chicken, mashed potatoes, and some sweet tea. That's what we do in the South. So I don't know what your experience is, but hymnals, Jordan's right. They're sweet, true, sweet songs that reign forever. Well, it's good to be with you guys this morning. My name is John. I'm one of the pastors here on staff, and it's a privilege to be a pastor here at Harvest Bible Chapel. And I have the privilege today to open up God's word with you. I'm super fired up to be here and honored to do it. I love this campus. I love you guys. And we've been through a lot this year together, right? But your perseverance and your endurance has ministered to my heart in so many ways. And so Melissa and I love you guys. And yeah, we're super excited to be here. So if you have a Bible, turn to Colossians chapter 4. We're going to be looking at the last 11 verses this morning. And we are going to close out our verse by verse series on Satisfied. And man, what a journey. What a journey we've been on. We've covered a ton of ground. We started out by giving context to this letter that Paul writes. Paul is in prison, in chains, and he actually has never been to the church of Colossae. So he hasn't met a lot of these people, but he says in chapter 1 that he has great affection and love for these people. And he thanks them for their faith, and he's super encouraged by their love for the Lord. And then we spent a week in chapter 1 going over the highest verses in the Bible of who Jesus is. It's one of my favorite passages in the Bible. And then we were reminded in chapter 3 what to put on and put off as God's chosen ones. And then we looked at what it means to be thankful, what it means to be thankful to the Lord in all seasons of life, and what it means to submit to one another in different roles. And then Pastor Craig, last week he taught us about prayer and how to be an effective witness to the gospel that many of you have accepted in your life. And so today, if you've ever read the book of Colossians or you glanced ahead to the last 11 verses, you'll see a bunch of names listed. And so I don't know if you're like me, but whenever I've come to a passage of scripture when it's a bunch of genealogies or lists of people, I might have the temptation to skim over it quick. Am I alone in that? Can I say that this morning? Skim right past it or quickly read fast? And maybe be of the belief that these passages aren't as important and that it won't be as applicable to me as other passages. But I want to remind us, church, this morning that 2 Timothy 3:16 says that all scripture is breathed out by God, that it was inspired by the Holy Spirit, and it's profitable for teaching and training for every good work in righteousness. And so these people that we're going to look at this morning was Paul's crew. Like, this was his inner circle. This was his team. And without them, his ministry, his letters would never, and his travels would never have happened. Would never have happened. And they're in the Bible for a reason. And Paul wasn't trying to fill up white space or blank space on the letter. He wasn't trying to do that. But I believe wholeheartedly that the Holy Spirit, being God, the Trinity, knew that we would be here this day, thousands of years later, going over this passage in Colossians 4, and that it would be profitable for us this morning. So we're there, church. Amen? Amen. Amen. Let's pray before we dig. God, thank you for this morning. God, I just pray this simple prayer that Holy Spirit, that you would illuminate our hearts to your word, and that I would speak clearly and urgently, and that Jesus would be made known through your word this morning, and that it would be of help to us as Christians. And those of us who haven't made that decision, God, perhaps this is the day. Perhaps this is the day for someone to come to you. We love you so much in Christ, let me pray. Amen. Well, if you're taking notes, you'll look at the title of today's message. It's called Better Together. Fulfilling our ministry takes a team. And isn't this so true in so many places in life, church, that we're better together. We're better together than isolated or alone. For sure, I'm a better pastor because of our pastoral team. I'm a better person because of you. I'm for sure a better man because my wife, Melissa, we all get that, right? Like, way better person. Sports teams, when they're united on the same mission, going striving toward the same goal, they're better and they can go further. And that's the truth about God's people, the church, that we're better together. We're better together. Oh, this time last year, Melissa and I, we were able to go to Yosemite National Park in California. It was highly suggested by a few people, and we've never been there before. And so we went there, and it was incredible. And so if you've ever been to Yosemite, or you haven't, there's two ways to get there. There's only two roads, because it's really kind of out in the middle of nowhere. It's not near a beach in California. It's on the east side of the state of California. And so either way you enter into the park, the first view of Yosemite is breathtaking. I have a photo of what Yosemite looks like when you first go. This is called tunnel view, and this is the first thing you see. And so, like, Melissa and I, we saw this, we were like, oh, my goodness. Like, it doesn't look real. It looks like a painting. It's so grand, and it points, obviously, to our Creator, God. And so we visit Yosemite, and there is one of the sites to see, one of the main attractions, is a rock wall called El Capitan. And El Capitan stands about 3,000 feet tall from bottom to top, which is two Willis or Sears towers stacked upon each other. And so we go to the bottom of El Capitan, that's right there, and we're at the bottom, we're even closer to the bottom, and this place attracts rock climbers from all across the world to come climb this. Like, I would never do that. Like, my hands are sweating right now just thinking about attempting that. And so Melissa and I, we're at the bottom of El Capitan, and we're like, well, maybe there's no one climbing the El Capitan this week. And so there was a couple that had binoculars, and they heard us, and they said, actually, there's like 50 people up there. You just can't see them. We're like, what? And they gave us their binoculars, and through the binoculars, you would see these tents, like little tents. It looked like ants on the rock face. And so just the thought of like spending the night on a rock face like that just gives, ugh, I don't know. I could never do it. Not could. I would never. I couldn't. I would be like, I'm out. But there was a movie that Melissa and I just watched last night called The Dawn Wall, and these rock climbers set out to free climb El Capitan. There's a picture. This is Tommy, and then the other gentleman was named Kevin. And so what free climbing is where climbers will use rope and equipment only to save them from, like, death or injury, but it doesn't, like, help them progress up the rock wall. And so what we found in this movie and documentary is that these two guys are encouraging one another. They're waiting for one another. I don't want to spoil it. It's on Netflix. But one guy can't make this. They call it a pitch, like a jump. And the other guy could have gone on up the wall, but he waits for his friend and stays back. And so you see these two guys just encouraging one another through it all. And I tell you that, use that illustration, because listen, we're better together. We're better together, not isolated as the body of Christ. We need to encourage one another on our walk and our pursuit of Jesus. And we can lean on one another when we're weak or when we're in need. And we definitely can have greater impact when we're unified under the mission of Jesus Christ. And so that's what I want to talk about this morning. That's what the Apostle Paul is going to say. And so I have four truths this morning. And so if you're taking notes, the first blank is this: faithful servants bring encouragement. Faithful servants bring encouragement. So let's look at our text this morning, starting in verse 7. Tychicus will tell you all about my activities. He is a beloved brother and faithful minister and fellow servant in the Lord. I have sent him to you for this very purpose, that you may know how we are and that he may encourage your hearts. So let's talk about this guy named Tychicus. Tychicus is mentioned five times in the Bible. We really don't know his full story, but we do know that he's from the province of Asia and was converted during one of Paul's missionary journeys in Greece. So Paul disciples him, and he ends up traveling with Paul quite a bit. He's even with Paul until the very end. Paul, when he's martyred for the faith, he's with two guys, Luke and then Tychicus. So he travels quite a bit with the Apostle Paul. And to give some context, Tychicus was kind of like the behind the scenes kind of guy. Obviously, he's not as well known as like Paul or Peter. He's very behind the scenes. He served the Lord and served Paul. And Paul sends him to the church of Colossae for two reasons. Number one, to inform the church of Colossae of what Paul's doing, his activities, to give him the update, and to deliver three letters: the letter of Colossians, which is what we're in, Ephesians, and Philemon. So he sends him. He's kind of like the mailman. Can you imagine having that job? Like delivering what would be the word of God? I just wonder if like Paul brought him aside and was like, hey, Tychicus, man, I love you. You're a faithful, beloved brother, but we didn't make extra copies of these letters. You know, we didn't make extra copies. We don't have like a hard drive. This is the word of God. So let's not mess this one up. All right, get it to point A to point B. And then Paul names another guy. Let's look at verse 9. And with him, Onesimus, our faithful and beloved brother, who is one of you. They will tell you of everything that has taken place. Now, Onesimus might be a familiar character in the Bible. His story is found here, but also much more detailed in the book of Philemon. He was a slave under Philemon, and he escaped. He ran away from under Philemon. He violates some laws. He steals some things. He just has a bad start, right? He just has a bad start to life. And by God's sovereignty, he runs into the Apostle Paul. And the Apostle Paul preaches, the gospel to him, and he receives Jesus as his Lord and Savior. And Paul disciples him. And then Paul gets real with him. If you've ever read like any of Paul's letters, Paul doesn't like shy back from being real with anybody, right? Like he says what he needs to be said, and he says this to Onesimus. He says, Onesimus, you need to go back to Philemon. You need to go back to Philemon, and you need to seek reconciliation and forgiveness. You need to do this. And so Paul writes a letter, which is the letter of Philemon. He sends it with Onesimus. And basically, if you ever read the book of Philemon, Paul's letter says, Philemon, Onesimus is a brother. He's accepted the gospel now. He's one of us. Give him his freedom. I know he's made mistakes. I know he ran away from you, but treat him as I would treat you. And if there's anything that he has done that's wrong, you just charge it to my account. So like Paul goes to bat for him, and he says, let the gospel move into those spaces and reconcile your relationship. And so Onesimus, these two guys, Tychicus and Onesimus, become like two guys that Paul is like super proud of. He's super proud of these guys. They're faithful, devoted, they're loyal, and then entrusted to deliver these letters. And yes, Onesimus had a bad start, but the gospel transformed him, and he's a new person. And so Paul leans on them to deliver the letters because he's unable to. Paul was in prison. And so this shows us, some application here, this shows us that ministry, the kingdom of God, is not a solo act. It's not a solo act. It's not a one-man show. The church doesn't hinge on a pastor. It doesn't hinge on a few people. But the church, the way God designed the church, is for believers. All believers have a gift if they're in Christ. They have time, talents, and treasures, and we collectively come together, and we're on one mission. Like, there's not a ton of missions. There's one mission. The mission is to make disciples and make Jesus known. But it might look different for all of us. It might look different for all of us. You might have a gift that I don't have, and that's okay. And Pastor Mo, our Niles campus pastor, we were discussing our sermons last night, and he gave me this insight. I love this. I don't have it on the screen, but if you want to write it down, you can. He said that there is no insignificant role or people in the kingdom of God. There is no insignificant job, role, or people in the kingdom of God. And I just want to take a second and say one of my favorite things to do on a Sunday morning, besides worshiping and opening God's word with you guys, is to walk around our campus while worship is going on and seeing all the various volunteers that it takes to run our campus. Like, for sure, Craig and I and Jordan and our kids team and administrative team couldn't do it on our own. But we have hundreds of you that are with our kids that help with worship. We have ushers, the parking team. Everybody has a gift. Everybody has a passion. Everybody has a job to serve the Lord and to serve the kingdom. And that's not even mentioning, like, the small groups that meet throughout the week. That's not mentioning, like, Awana, right? That's not mentioning student ministry volunteers. And I love seeing the people of God coming together collectively under one mission together. And these are Paul's guys. This is his team. Without these guys, Paul's letters wouldn't have been delivered. His ministry couldn't have gone on. So praise God for these guys in Paul's life. So let me ask you just this real quick point of application. Where are you serving the kingdom of God? Where are you serving? Where are you being faithful to the gifts that God has given you. Where are you serving? And if you don't know, we'd love to help you find out. We'd love to give you a place to try out. Where are you serving? These two men also brought encouragement. This is our overall point for the first one. These men brought encouragement to Paul. The Colossians, although they had never met Paul, they were very concerned about his activities. Be like, yeah, like Paul was in prison. So it'd be like if you had a loved one that was in prison, you'd want an update. You'd want to know what's going on. Same with the Colossians. And so Tychicus and Onesimus become this huge support base and encouragement for the church of Colossae. And so I want to ask you, church, this question. Who is someone in your life that needs encouragement? Who is someone in your life that needs encouragement? Maybe some of you guys are saying, well, Pastor John, I need encouragement. Yeah, we all do. But who is someone that you can encourage? I want to say this, that during this season of life in our church, that I feel super encouraged by you. Like the text, the emails, the phone calls, the pat on the back, the how you doing, Pastor John, keep going. Like that's meant so much to me. And this is what encouragement does. It keeps you going. It's positive. It lifts you up. It keeps you going. It helps you endure. It helps you persevere. It creates bonds between us, doesn't it? Like it unifies us together. And we're all on the same team. And we all need encouragement. So maybe this is something for you to do today. Maybe on your notes, write a few names of people that you can encourage. Write a few names of people that you can encourage today or this week. Maybe it's someone going through a tough season. Maybe they have a prodigal. Maybe someone in their life was diagnosed with an illness or someone passed away suddenly. Or even positive feedback. Maybe it's one of our graduates. Encourage them for their accomplishments. Or maybe it's someone that you work with and they've been doing like a super good job at their task and their job. And instead of being envious, maybe a promotion or jealous, maybe write them a card or text or even better say it in person and say, congratulations, I'm proud of you, great job. Who can you encourage? Maybe it's someone in your small group that you've seen a lot of growth in. You could say, you know what, I've seen the gospel transform you so much. Like your conversations, your prayers have just been incredible. Praise God for you. You know how much that would mean to someone? Like we all get that would mean so much to us. So let's reciprocate that and do that unto other people. The second truth that we're better together as we fulfill our ministry as a team is this: present friends bring comfort. Present friends bring comfort. Isn't that the truth? Let's look at verse 10. Aristarchus, my fellow prisoner, greets you, and Mark, the cousin of Barnabas, concerning whom you have received instructions. If he comes to you, welcome him. And Jesus, who is also called Justice, it's important to note that this is not Jesus like Jesus Christ, Messiah. It's a different Jesus. These are the only men of the circumcision among my fellow workers for the kingdom of God, and they have been, I underlined this, a comfort to me. They have been a comfort to me. When Paul says that these are the men of circumcision, he means that these are Jews that have converted to Christianity, which wasn't a super popular thing then, and even today it's not a super popular thing either. And then he mentions three men that have been super important to his life. The first one is Aristarchus. Aristarchus, there's a lot of names pronounced this morning. Aristarchus, and this guy was a huge comfort to Paul. He traveled with Paul quite a bit, and I want to remind us all that traveling with Paul wasn't exactly like a relaxing, fun vacation. If you've ever read and know about the life of Paul, you know that Paul was shipwrecked three times, and at the end of one of those, like a snake bites him. I'm being like, come on, like the shipwreck couldn't be enough, right? He was in prison. He was flogged. He was stoned, almost to the point of death. And then he says in 2 Corinthians 12, even the anxieties and pressures of the church were taxing on him. And then he was in prison. He was always on the run because of the gospel. He suffered much, and Aristarchus was with him through it all, through the thick and thin of life. And listen, if you have a friend like that doesn't walk out on you when it's tough, like if you have one or two of those people in your life, you're super blessed. Like we can all agree with that, right? Like if we have someone in our life like that, we're blessed, and they're a huge encouragement. And this was Aristarchus to the Apostle Paul. He also mentions Mark and Barnabas. This is the same Mark that ends up writing the Gospel of Mark with the help of Peter. The background of these three men is that they had a disagreement. They went on a missionary journey together, Paul, Mark, and Barnabas, and the Bible tells us that Mark leaves. He deserts them, and so Barnabas and Paul are about to take another missionary journey, and Barnabas is like, let's take Mark, and Paul's like, no, we're not taking him. And Acts 15 says that Paul sharply disagrees to take Mark with them, and so they go their separate ways. They have a disagreement. They go their separate ways. But 2 Timothy 4 says that Mark is a changed man. He's a changed man. So maybe he realized his error, and then these three men are reconciled. They reconcile their relationship. And so Paul says, here he says in verse 10, Mark, the cousin of Barnabas, concerning whom you've received instructions, if he comes to you, welcome him. Receive him. Welcome him back to the church. And then the third guy that Paul mentions is Jesus, who is also called Justice. And honestly, we don't know a lot about him. We know his name. We know that he's not the Jesus. We know that he's a Jew that converted to Christianity and that he was a comfort to Paul. And so I guess there could be worse things that you could be known for in the Bible. Loving Jesus and comforting arguably the greatest missionary is not a bad thing at the end of the day to be known for. But we really don't know much about him. So these three men become a support system, a comfort to Paul. They were sympathetic to what Paul would go through, meaning that their burdens were the same. Paul's burdens was their burdens. And these three men were in prison together. They prayed together. And I'm sure there was a lot of conversations of them airing out frustrations, conversations of each other reminding one another of the promises of God, conversations reminding them the hope that's found in Jesus Christ and how good God is even when life is tough. And so they kept each other going. They kept Paul going in the ministry, and they were present. They were present and were a comfort to Paul. Well, this past January, I received one of the hardest phone calls, January 24th, in my life. One of my good friends, brother in Christ, mentors in ministry, Jim Howard, who was a pastor in a very large-sized church in California, committed suicide in California. And obviously, it was a shock to us. And anybody that knew Jim really well knew that he struggled with depression. He struggled with high anxiety and for sure despair. But obviously, it was a surprise. He gave us no warning that he was going to take his own life. He left a letter for his wife, but it was a very hard, difficult phone call, as you can imagine, to take. And the background story with Jim and myself, I started out at our last church at 22 years old as a youth pastor, so like didn't know what I was doing. I knew I had a passion for the Lord and passion for students, and he helped me understand how ministry worked and bridge those two things together to make it work. So started out that he would check in on me, call me, text me, just see how I'm doing, which led to when he'd come in to Kentucky, he would take me out for lunch or dinner and just really like pour in and invest in me. So I really appreciated him. And we actually interviewed with him and his church before we accepted the position to come to Harvest. And we're so thankful we came to Harvest. And it was a shock to hear this news. Just didn't see it coming. And I remember telling Melissa the news. And I was just really still in shock, and just it was just so like surreal. I just couldn't believe that Jim was gone, and that he would do such a thing. And I remember my wife Melissa just being present with me there, just being present. She'd ask me questions like, "Hey, like, are you okay? What can I do for you? Can I take something off your plate?" I remember telling Pastor Craig in his office. I was sitting on his couch, and Pastor Craig, I remember even his posture. He just leaned forward in his chair. He said, "I'm so sorry, Pastor John. What can I do?" Pastor Craig even said, "Hey, if you need to take time off to go to the funeral and see friends and family, please do that. Take your time. And if I can help you process anything, just let me know." And that was such a comforting thing. I don't know if Craig understood the gravity of what he said to me, but it weighed so deeply and resonated with me. I remember telling my 6 a.m. men's small group, and they prayed for me too. And I remember talking with my friends and family about it. On and on, these people were present. It reminded me of this over and over, this one truth, that one of the best gifts that the Lord has given us is one another. And one of the best gifts that God has given us is the body of believers, that we can be there for one another, that we can be present. And sometimes being present and comforting someone means you pray for them. Sometimes it means you speak a word of encouragement. Sometimes it means not saying anything, but just being there. When times are troubling or times are hard, we need to move to one another. We need to move to one another. We don't need to stay in isolation. We don't need to stay by ourselves all the time. Maybe it's good to be away for a little bit and withdraw for a little bit, but not completely. And we need one another. We need to bear one another's burdens, carry them if possible. And these men were that for Paul. These men were that for Paul. So again, I ask you, who are you being a comfort to? Who is someone that you know, that you have a relationship with, that you can be a comfort to? Because listen, we all experience things. Life happens, right? Life happens. I've had 4 or 5 conversations with people this week who are going through a rough time. And we need one another. Paul needed these men. Number 3, we're moving right along. Hard transition. Hardworking intercessors bring strength. Hardworking intercessors bring strength. Intercessor is just a fancy word for prayer. Let's read verse 12 and following. Epaphras, who is one of you, a servant of Christ Jesus, greets you, always struggling on your behalf in his prayers, that you may stay mature and fully assured in all the will of God. For I bear witness that he has worked hard for you and for those in Laodicea and in Hierapolis. Now, Epaphras' story, he was on what would be called like or known as a business trip in Ephesus. And he heard Paul preach the gospel. Are you hearing a trend here, how these people, by God's sovereignty, would just show up to Paul's preaching and they hear the gospel? Same thing with Epaphras. He heard the gospel, responds in faith. Paul ends up discipling him, and he ends up planting the church of Colossae. He plants the church of Colossae. And so when Paul says, he is one of you, a servant, and greets you, to the Colossians, when they heard this, they're like, yeah, like that's our pastor. Like, that's our guy. He planted this church. He is our pastor. We know him, and he greets him. And so currently, he's not with the church of Colossae. He's in prison with Paul. What a friend and brother. And Paul wants them to know 2 things. First off, that he's praying for them. And secondly, that he's working hard on their behalf. That he's praying for them and working on their behalf. Now, when I was reading this passage of preparation, when it says, always struggling on your behalf in his prayers, I really honestly didn't know what that meant. I get that he was praying, but I didn't understand right away what it meant that he was struggling in his prayers. He wasn't struggling to pray, but struggling in his prayers. And so a little background on that. The word struggle is where we get our English word agonize. Agonize. And it means to engage in an intense struggle or fight, whether it's non-physical or physical. And really the picture here is 2 athletes competing against one another for the prize. Like they're struggling, they're fighting, they're agonizing over who's going to win the championship or prize. And so Epaphras is struggling in his prayers. And his prayers is this for his people, that they will stand mature, fully assured in all of the will of God. So Epaphras might be far from them distant-wise, but his mind and his heart is right there with them. He's present with them in his spirit and in his heart, praying on their behalf. And so Epaphras knew that there was work to be done, even though he was absent. And he prays on their behalf, and he approaches the throne of God with confidence, pleading that the people of Colossae would continue to grow in maturity in the likeness of Christ, and that the work of the kingdom would not cease. And the prayers are working. That's why Paul, at the beginning, says, I'm thankful for the work and the faith that you have. Like, his prayers are working. His prayer life was intense. It was urgent. It was selfless as he prayed on their behalf. And I know many of us in here, we want that kind of prayer life, right? Like, we want that kind of prayer life where we're approaching the throne of God with confidence and boldness and praying for things to happen. But I know at times in my life, if I could be honest, and maybe you could be honest too, don't raise your hand, but sometimes I struggle to pray like this. I struggle to pray. I struggle to pray with urgency. I struggle to pray with boldness. And so if this is you, I want to give you just a quick, easy model of how to get started or how to pray more fervently and with more intensity and urgency. The first is this cool acrostic. You might have heard this. It's called ACTS. many guys have heard of the acrostic acts of how to pray? Yes, it's super helpful. The A stands for adoration. These are prayers of basically saying, God, you're awesome. There's no one like you. You are holy, set apart, creator, sustainer of life. Prayers of adoration. The second is confession. These are prayers of confessing sin, of repenting of sin. God, I have sinned against you and maybe perhaps sinned against someone else. And I come to you asking for a clean heart. Forgive me. Forgive me. This is where I'm at. You have thanksgiving. Thanksgiving. This is thanking God for the gifts that he's given us. James 1 says, every good and perfect gift comes from the Father of lights. Thanking God for the blessings that you have in your life. And the last one is supplication. This is another fancy word for asking. You're probably most familiar with this in your prayer life, asking God for things. And this is what Epaphras is doing. He's asking that they would continue to grow in the likeness of Christ, that they would grow in their maturity and understanding of God. And again, maybe some of you guys, you're like, I want that prayer life. Well, here's a model. And also, it's helpful to me to find a place, to find a place and to develop a plan of when to pray, like in the mornings. And prayer doesn't have to be just stuck to that. It can be prayer throughout the day. Like whenever I'm in my car, I try to pray then, or when I'm by myself, I pray, or when I'm out for a jog or a run or a bicycle ride by myself, I pray then. It never has to cease. When you say amen, it doesn't mean like you're done. It's not what it means. And I love how the Westminster Catechism describes prayer. It says that prayer is an offering of our desires unto God in the name of Christ, with the help of his Spirit, with confession of sins and thankful acknowledgement of his mercies. And a lot of us, we're really good at communicating and offering up our desires and thoughts to ourselves, like our fears, our anxieties. But that's prayer inverted. It's prayer inverted. Prayer is offering up those desires to God. It's offering up desires to God. And so I pray that we would become a church that prays like Epaphras, that struggling in prayer is not struggle to pray. Finally this morning, shared ministry brings growth. Shared ministry brings growth. In verse 14, Paul writes with his own hand, Luke, the beloved physician, greets you, as does Demas. This is the same Luke that writes the Gospel of Luke in Acts. Luke was a physician, and he traveled with Paul quite a bit, and he would basically be there to comfort and encourage him, but also kind of put Paul back together health-wise as he endured beatings and sufferings for the gospel. And Demas, we don't know a ton about him. We know that he had a really good start. He follows Jesus early on. But in 2 Timothy 4:10, which is one of the last letters that Paul would write before he is martyred for his faith, verse 10 says, For Demas, in love with the present world, has deserted me and gone to Thessalonica. So Demas abandoned his faith, and we don't know why. We don't know if he comes back to the Lord. We just don't have that in the scriptures. But I know, as a student pastor, and maybe you too, you know people that have walked away from the faith. You know people that have abandoned their walk with Jesus Christ or have left the church. I think one of the hardest things as a student pastor is to see students walk away from their faith, especially after they graduate. There's this horrible stat that I think it's 60 to 70% of high school graduates not only graduate from high school, but the saying is they graduate from their faith and abandon church and leave their faith. And it's super sad. Super sad, and maybe you know someone that's abandoned their faith, and you know how much hurt, and you grieve about it. But I do know this, that the love and grace and kindness of God is always ready to welcome someone back home, amen? God's always ready to welcome a prodigal back home. He's always ready to give more grace, to give and extend an arm of kindness. And so if that's you today, maybe you're trying out this church thing again. Just know that you can come to Jesus for free and that he's ready to accept you. He's ready to welcome you back into his family. And know this, if that's you today, the heavens and your church will rejoice. The heavens and your church will rejoice. And that's my heart and the Bible's heart and obviously Jesus' heart for you this morning if that's you. And Paul mentions a couple other people, the brothers at Laodicea. He mentions Nympha. Nympha is interesting. We believe that she was a woman, and we believe, well, the text says it, she opens her home for the church. So church is literally meeting at her house. And so it wasn't a super popular thing for churches just to erect like our church in those times. And so she opens her house so that the people of God can have a place to worship and hear the word of God. And that tells me and tells us this morning that if you don't have the gift of teaching, or maybe the gift of worship leading, or you don't think your gift is with kids or ushering, if you have the gift of just simply opening up your life and house to people, that's just important. That's just important. If you are the person that loves to build relationships and connect people, like network people, that is a gift that's needed to build up the kingdom and church. And so this was her gift, and praise God for Nympha and her ministry. Let's look at verse 16. And when this letter has been read among you, have it also read in the church of the Laodiceans, and see that you also read the letter from Laodicea. Apparently, there's other letters that Paul wrote. We don't have them. It's all good. They're not in our Bible. And he says to have this letter read aloud. And the reason why he says that is because a lot of people in these days were illiterate. They couldn't read, and so someone would have to literally read the letter to them so that they could understand and hear the word of God and be given the update of Paul's journeys. And so, in closing, we're closing out our look at the book of Colossians this morning. It's been an incredible journey. I wanted to say this as a reminder. Everybody that's in Christ Jesus, you have a ministry. You are on the same team. We're united under the same mission. It might look different. Your role might look different for the church, but we're on the same team. You have a role that's equally important, and we don't need to be in the business about coveting or being jealous about other people's gifts or ministries or talents. Whatever God has given you, do that to the glory of God. And serve and give your life and steward those times and talents. And I promise you this, that God will use you beyond your capacity. He'll use you more than what you are capable of and what you could ever dream, think, or imagine. God is in the business of using people that are just available. He's not so concerned about your abilities. He's more concerned about your availability. And so if this is you and you're not in a place, talk to someone. Talk to someone, because we need you on our team. We need you on our team. The book of Colossians shows us that Christ is enough and satisfies and can satisfy anybody. And Paul, in the book of Colossians, like some of his other letters, doesn't have any strong rebukes. He doesn't call anybody out. He doesn't call wolves out or anything, but he's thankful for their faith and the love that they have for one another. And may this be said of us. May this be said of us, that Christ alone satisfies us. The cares of the world weren't satisfying us, but Christ alone satisfied our hearts and will, and that we were better together. May we be known that we are better together, fulfilling the Great Commission and the ministries that God gave us. Amen. Amen. Let's pray. God, thank you for this time. Thank you for the gospel. And God, maybe some of us in here, we weren't super familiar with any of these people that Paul mentions in his letter to the Colossians. But God, we know that they're important. We know now that they were important to Paul's ministry. God, I pray that every single person in this room realizes that they're important to what you're doing. There's no insignificant role. There's no insignificant person. But God, we are united together in the gospel of Jesus Christ, and we have one mission, and that's to make Jesus known. So God, we're thankful for the work that you're doing in our church and our campus. We're thankful for the stories and testimonies. We're thankful that we can gather here on Memorial Day weekend. We're grateful for the freedoms that we have been given because of the men and women that have died so that we can meet for free with little or no persecution. So God, I pray that we'd be an encouragement to someone this week. I pray that if the opportunity presents itself, that we'd be a comfort to someone. And I pray that we would love well and do good to one another. In Christ, let me pray. Amen.